Much Music special presentation.
We are going to be talking to one of the biggest names in rock and roll today. They sold millions of albums, won tons of Grammys, and we've got them for the full hour. Tonight, we are going to be talking to them about their darkest times and how close they came to breaking down. They're playing the hits as well as material off their brand new album, The Open Door. Make some noise for Evanescence.
Thank you so much. Break. The band talks about the darkest times and why Amy unplugged her phone for an entire year. Plus, you can phone, you can email, you can text. It's an interactive show. It's live at lunch. Stay tuned. More music to come, but in the meantime, we are joined by Amy and Terry. Ladies and gentlemen.
Yes.
Or lady and gentlemen.
Yes.
Welcome, by the
Thank
way.
Thank you.
You're making it very warm on a very cold night here in Toronto.
Thank you. It's getting warmer in here.
On behalf of everyone in Toronto and Canada, welcome to Much Music yet again.
It's great to be back. We love it here. The fans are awesome.
They are. Thank you all for being here as well. Now, we're here in celebration of the Open Door, and from what I've been reading, it means a bunch of different things to both of you. It's the side of a new friendship, and as well, letting go of a lot of things, a lot of hang-ups musically and personally as well, correct?
I've opened my doors to you, Terry. word. Yeah, early on in the writing process, we just felt like we had so much freedom that I didn't feel like I had before as a writer and as a person and everything else. I was just too insecure to do all the things that I really, really dreamed to do, like all the way. So this album has a lot more fun on it. Just a lot more, I don't know, fun. It's fun to play.
Have you been able to tap into where those insecurities came from?
I think it's just part of growing up. I definitely think it's just part of, you know, I don't know, when you're young and you're impressionable and, I don't know, someone tells you suck and you think, yeah, I must suck. So now I know, I don't think I suck.
That would be nice.
Sometimes it is just being older. Sometimes there are key moments in one's life where you realize those kinds of things. Did you have that, maybe that one epiphany where you're like, well, you know what, forget about that?
I don't know, not really. It's definitely a learning thing, you know, just growing up and realizing a lot of the times, you know, you need to trust yourself, and especially if it's about what you do and what you love and what you put your heart into. And this band means a lot to me, and I don't want to hold anything back from it anymore, writing wise. So we definitely put it all out there, and I couldn't have done it without Terry. Definitely bouncing off of ideas off of each other was like an amazing experience. He's very creative.
Well, I wonder about that as well. I mean,
yes.
I've been reading a lot. You were talking about self-doubt so much on the last album and with you. Where do you trust yourself the most now? Each of you, not just Amy, you as well, Terry. Where do you trust yourself the most? I mean, what inherent traits do you trust the most in yourself?
I don't know. I think we should definitely trust ourselves more than anybody else on our opinion on our own art, definitely. Fallen was a lot of things that I wanted, but it was also a lot of people sort of trying to control it and make it something, and I don't know. I was thinking, okay, I gotta be cool. So I can't ever be sort of like in a good mood. It was always pain and darkness and suffering and a lot of horrible things. And that's cool. I mean, that's definitely still the new album, all the struggle and challenges of life. But there's some real, like, good stuff and even sort of funny stuff, too.
Well, I have read that. You were saying that even in the darker, sad songs, there is that happiness. Where is that happiness coming from?
I guess I just see that the world is a lot bigger than just this band now. And I think that, I don't know, it's all important, it all matters, and I love this so much and I want to do it for a long time. But in the end, I mean, things happen like Terry's stroke and him surviving, and it's almost like you just realize that we're really small and fragile and all this is so fickle, and what really matters is the people you love and your life. And I don't know, once you get the big picture, it's like, it's not so hard to sort of put things in perspective.
When that kind of thing happens, I mean, Terry, with your stroke, being close friends, it must be hard to A, see your friend, you know, go through that kind of thing. But as well, it must have been really hard for you, the idea of just not being able to play music.
Yeah, it's still difficult. I'm still, like, going through the paralysis and all that crap. So,
mm-hmm.
But, you know, you can only just keep trying.
I mean, were there times where you thought that it might not happen, where you might not get it back?
Yeah, for a long time, actually, for a good 6-7 months after the stroke.
He was stubborn, though. He was working so hard every day. I remember one of the doctors, at least, but a couple of them were kind of like, nah, he's never really going to play guitar again. So
really?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, he could go like that, and that was about it with his arm.
I watched a lot of Rocky movies, and I can.
Yeah.
Have you seen the new one? I hear it's pretty good.
No, I haven't. Did you?
Yeah,
don't give
absolutely.
Anything away, because you gave it away to all the rest of the band. We were all like, ah!
Because Rocky V was just so disappointing. It should have ended at Rocky IV, going to the Soviet Union.
Well,
I agree.
But, yeah, now our pre-show music is like Eye of the Tiger and other uplifting songs. What?
We are going to come outside, by the way. We are. I promise you we're going to come outside.
Oh, they're calling some name of mine.
There's
a lot of nicknames.
Love and nickname?
No, just kidding. Skip this. Let's go. no comments.
There's a lot of, there's really one great line in Call Me When You're Sober where you talk about the idea of making up someone else's mind. Would you consider yourself a decisive person?
Yeah. That's sort of, you know, sarcastic and funny. I mean, it's real, but it's sort of like, instead of waiting for you to make up your mind anymore, I'm going to go ahead and change the situation myself, because that's what I should have done all along. You know, when you're stuck somewhere negative, it's like, you're the one who has to make the decision to pull yourself out of it and get somewhere better. You can't rely on somebody else to fix it for you.
Absolutely. We've got a fantastic clip of one of, I believe, our first interview with you ever.
Oh, no.
You want to just take a look right up here?
I feel a lot more at home all by myself in my room, just locking myself away for 10 hours trying to pound out the lyrics or something, than on stage where, you know, you're completely subject to judgment.
There you go. What's it like looking back in yourself four years ago?
I couldn't really hear what I said, but I could see it looks like a completely different person. It's crazy.
But you were a different person as well. I mean, you get the unique opportunity to look back not only in pictures and video form, but in music as well. That must be pretty unique.
Well, yeah, you get to, I don't know, grow up. That's sort of interesting. But at the same time, it's like weird. What did I say? What did I just say in the clip? You don't even know. You can't hear either.
I think you were just talking about the idea of performing and being more comfortable on stage as well. Do you feel more comfortable?
Yeah, it definitely took some time. I remember at first, when we were first playing shows, I was like 15. And it was like, for the whole show, I'd stand behind a mic stand with my eyes closed, like not moving, just standing there and not talking between songs, just right into the next song, you know. Just because it was so weird to be up on stage when I felt like, why do I deserve this? Why shouldn't all the people in the crowd be just equal with me? I don't know. It was a weird thing. And it's not that I deserve to be up here more, but it's like, I don't know. You have to learn to express yourself and go, okay, I'm on stage, and I don't know, putting my heart out there.
Well, you do deserve it. We've got an audience question from Christina.
Hey, how are you? My question is, if any of your songs, which song would you want to be, like, to have covered by, and by who?
Ooh. Well,
that's hard.
Can you think of anything? Covered by. It's like, who could do it better than us?
Do you guys cover songs?
Huh?
Do you cover songs? We have, yeah.
We aren't right now. We finally have enough songs in our own library to just play an Evanescence show. So, yes. I don't know. Who do you love? Who would, like, be a cool person to cover one of our songs?
The problem with this band, and it's not a problem, but there's not that many contemporaries in this music industry in the female form. There's not many women who could do what you do.
Well, you know what's cool? I think the coolest thing about covers of someone is if someone else you admire covers something completely different, like a completely different artist from a different genre or whatever covers it really cool. Like Tori Amos doing a cover of like Nirvana Smells Like Teen Spirit. That was the bomb.
Yeah.
That was awesome. Because it showed like this completely new light on what it really meant. So I don't know. I can't think of anything.
I think Gnarls Barkley Crazy was the most covered song all year.
Really?
It was interesting to see all the different takes, yeah. We've got an email question from Emma, and she wants to know, I was wondering if people have ever accused you, Amy, of being too negative or being too dark with regards to your writing at any time in your life.
Yeah. Like every other day. Totally.
Really?
Yeah, sure. Being too dark?
Yeah.
Yeah. Because it's weird. You know, our music kind of encompasses so many things and so many genres and so many different people that, you know, might understand it or like it or whatever, that some people think, I don't know, it's either too much of the dark or too much of the light or whatever, because it's all over the place. It's hard to explain. We mix classical with like metal and like rock and like kind of some soul influence. There's like a little bit of everything in there. So I don't know, for the people who only like soul, I don't know, there's a lot to look at and go, whoa, that's heavy.
I heard very early on in your career, your mom was worried too when she was reading lyrics. Is that true?
Yeah, I said that one time. It's true. I don't know. She heard me singing. I was like, check it out. It's so awesome. I wrote this song. I don't remember what it was about or whatever, and I played it for her, and I thought it was really cool, and I was like sharing with her. And she looked at me, and she was just like, do we need to take you to the doctor? Because you just need to be honest with me. Am I doing something wrong as a mother? And I was like, no, I'm just expressing myself. You don't understand me. I never showed her another song yet. No, that's not true. But, yeah.
Talking about family, I noticed there's a little, well, not little, it's pretty big, there's a little rock on your finger.
Uh-huh.
And I'm sorry, I have to ask about it.
I got engaged last night.
Congratulations. That's huge. That's huge.
Thank you. Thank
you.
So,
speaking of mom, does mom know yet?
Yeah, I talked to her this morning.
Okay, and question two, did he get on one knee?
Yeah, he did.
You must be so excited. That's fantastic.
Yes, it is. Thank you very much.
That's fantastic.
All rock right. Metal.
It's going to be tough to follow up, but Chris has got a question. He's on the phone from Mississauga. Chris, what's your question, my friend?
Oh, hi. Am I on?
Yeah, you're on.
Oh, well, first of all, Amy, I love your new album. Like, I think I went down 2 pant sizes since I bought it. The songs are so powerful, like, I have to jog while listening to them. Like, it gets me so pumped.
Why doesn't that work for me? That's awesome.
And the concert last night was amazing. Like, I teased.
Thank you.
But my question is, like, you come from a musical family, and in the cover for The Open Door, you can see that your sisters actually do background vocals on the single Call Me When You're Sober.
Yes.
So I was wondering if we can expect, like, any records from other Lee family members or a duet, maybe?
That's so sweet.
That's a good question.
Yeah, it's very possible. I know, though, that my sisters are very independent and different than me, and I don't think either of them want to, like, sort of use me as a way to get into the industry or something like that. So my one sister, they're both great singers, but I think my one sister is really going to be a writer. She's an amazing writer, and she's looking at awesome colleges. She has a huge GPA. It's really frightening. And nothing like me. And my
biggest brain ever.
Yes. And my other little sister is really all about music and plays multiple instruments and is really talented and always plays me new songs that she's written when we hang out together. So I do have faith in her, and I do think it's possible you'll see her in the future.
Great question. Kristen is research.
Very nice question.
All right.
I've never been asked that before.
Congratulations. That was a great question. I know it's really warm in here, but we got tons of people outside who've been waiting hours and hours. Do you want to go outside and say hello and answer some questions? All right, Evanescence is coming outside. Terry, you want to come too?
Yeah,
come
you
on
do.
Out. Come on out, my friends. Evanescence is coming out. The people who've been waiting.
Yeah.
Hey, what's your question for Amy and Terry?
Been trying to get me?
I wanted to ask you. Amy, when you go back to Arkansas and you see your high school friends, do they act, like, how do they react to you now that you're famous?
That's a good question. Going back home, what's going back home
it's
like,
weird.
10-year-old friends?
Well, my family's always cool, but, you know, Arkansas. It's a small town, so it's always all about that. And there's a lot of people that know me that I don't know. So it's kind of scary. You, like, go to Shakey's, and they're like, you remember we were in school together? You went to Central High? I'm like, no, I didn't go there. So.
Do you still keep in touch with those people?
Only a few. I have a few good friends that I've stayed in touch with. So let me sign.
Yeah, we got tons more to talk about, more music right after this. It's a live in
Thank
month.
You.
With Evanescence, more talk, more questions and answers to come, but in the meantime, more music. Here they are. break. Find out what riot police have to be called into the video for calling in the server. Stay tuned to our live match. You talked earlier on about the power of friendship and as well tying into the album title. And I wonder, when you're writing music, so much of it relies on trust and friendship. So what do each of you possess for one another that you've never experienced before in a friend?
I'll go first. Harry's awesome because... No, just kidding. Actually, it was really cool because not only is Terry really creative, but he's really supportive. So even when I come up with ideas that are really out of left field, he listens and either gets it or just is patient. So we'd go through a lot of just like messing around, you know, and just playing with ideas that were fun and totally weird and different, which was something new. And a lot of it is, you know, trust, because we'd already spent a lot of good time on the road together, just chilling, getting to know each other, and it wasn't hard to just write in front of him without feeling, I don't know, like judged or something. It was good.
No judging going on there, Terry?
You've had all that time to think of some one nice thing to say about me.
She's like my little sister.
I'm going to ask a question, and I don't want you to take it the wrong way. Do you have a lot of friends? And I ask this because, in that respect, it is a unique idea that you have this kind of bond with someone.
Yeah. No, actually, I mean, it's not that I don't have any friends, but it's like when you like sacrificed your life to like, because you're all over the place all the time, constantly busy and all over the world in different cities every day. It's really hard to keep up friendships like with people that aren't with you. So your band really becomes like the core of, you know, who you hang out with. They become your family. You really have to love each other and get along. Otherwise, you know, you're all alone. So I do have a few friends. We all have, you know, people that we love that aren't with us on tour that we miss a lot, but not a lot. I mean, it's not like a huge, well, at least not me. It's not like a huge group of people that are like, yeah, every time I come home. It's like just me and the cat.
Do you let people in like that, Terry? Like we were talking about?
Yeah, I mean, I have a lot of friends. Like when I go back home to Florida, tons of friends there and stuff.
It's a little more social.
Yeah, sometimes. Not in front of the camera, though.
It's all right. Amy, you've been the face of this band, and I guess there are positives and negatives that go along with that. Was that difficult starting out?
Yeah, actually, there's a lot that comes with that. I don't know how much detail to go into without, I don't want to hurt anybody else, but it can be hard, you know, learning your place in the band, you know, for me especially, and taking on a lot of the responsibilities and being the face and all that stuff. I don't know, I see a lot of bands, we tour with a lot of people, and I've definitely seen it go to people's heads, and it changes them completely. Like, you see them on tour, hey, and they're awesome and down to earth and new, and a couple of years later you see them and they've just changed completely, because it's like they've forgotten who they really are, and have become something new, and like something horrible. So it's weird. I think it's really important to just be friends, keep your friends around you, stay grounded, and remember, this is all really silly, and there's no reason for me to be like before, like on some huge high stage on top of everyone else, like I'm better or something. That's just my job, and I love my music, and I work really hard, and that's it.
Why do you think those kinds of, I mean, without naming any names, why do you think those kinds of things happen?
I don't know. I a lot of it's watching VH1 Behind the Music and seeing like all the glory of like, you know, fallen rock stars who go through their, you know, drug and alcohol abuse and like almost threw their lives away, and like they OD'd and then they made a new life and all this drama that I just don't really want in my life. I think a lot of people see, you know, their idols either party way too hard or just live this entire life that's impossible to live without really hurting yourself and hurting the people around you. And then they lose it all. And they're like, why did I lose it all? It's like, well, because you can't do that. you can, but you could also die. So I'd rather play music and, I don't know, see the fans again.
Terry, you've got the unique opportunity, whereas you get to see this whole thing from the inside out. You get to see it for what it is, but you kind of get to step back from everything as well. And what's it like seeing Amy go through the accolades, but as well as the low times?
What do you mean by a step back? And...
Well, I mean, like, Amy gets to be the face of this band.
Right.
You get to experience everything. I mean, all the great things.
Right.
And then...
You get to watch me steal all the glory.
Yeah, I get it. I got it made, you know.
Awesome. You don't have to talk as much that way.
Chill.
In the video for Everybody's Fool, it deals with, you know, isolation and those downsides of fame. Do you still identify with those things? You've kind of exercised them.
I don't know. It's funny, like, the whole thing about the first single being Call Me When You're Sober and it being so personal and blunt about something that isn't something I'd normally just tell the world was a little hard for me because I really felt like it was worth it for the song, and I loved how open the song was. But then it's hard when you go and do interviews and they want to hear the in-depth, you know, reasons behind every word that you've sung, and I have to sit around and, like, talk about things that hurt, you know, and things that may hurt other people for me to talk about. It kind of sucks. I'm learning how to hold back some things, and, you know, sometimes it hurts to see stuff in the press that's really personal, but you got to know that comes along with it. You keep some things to yourself and share as much as you can so people can understand the music.
Does it change the writing of songs when... In a second album situation, you know people are listening as well.
No. I definitely write for me. And I've shared more because it felt good to do so. And I knew the fans would like it because I just feel like it's so much more challenging and brave and cool. It's just like it's different. It's not the same old thing over and over again. I love Fallen, but we didn't want to make the same album over. It's like it's time for a new chapter.
You can fall into that trap as a band.
Yes, you can.
Yeah. Curtis has got an audience question. Speaking of fans, Curtis, what's your question for Amy and Terry?
My question is, where did you get the source for the different styles of songs on your albums? Was it like, say, opera, different bands?
There's a lot of different things that inspired. I know, well, one of them was Lacrimosa, so that's my favorite, thank you, piece of classical music. I love Mozart. He's always been a big inspiration for me. So, I don't know, years ago I thought it'd be a cool idea to take that song and mess it up and make it weird and heavy and strange. And we had so much fun demoing it. We were laughing because it was so dramatic and almost hilarious by the end of it because it's so huge. So that was that. But a lot of the inspiration just was new. I mean, I didn't feel like it was because we were listening to other bands as much as we were just being creative in the studio with weird noises and drum beats. I remember we went on a hunt for an antique typewriter because we wanted to sample, like, the noise of the typewriter, like all the different old-fashioned typewriter noises, and create a drum loop out of that and stuff like that. Just be weird. Take time to be strange.
I like that. I like that answer. Take time to be strange. I built my career on it. Alicia's got an audience question as well.
Since you guys have been on tour, do you get sick of playing the same songs over and over again, or do you still find it just as thrilling every time?
Yeah, Rocky said yeah. I look back, I knew I was looking for you. He sits there, like, falling asleep. I turned around, like, an imaginary the other day, and he was like... like, come on! Just change the part or something. No, it's cool. We do get kind of sick of some of the really old songs, because, like, a song like Imaginary, for example, we love the song, but it's been around for, like, 9 years or something. So we definitely memorized that one. I don't know. I think, enjoy playing a lot of the new songs now more than the old ones, just because they're fun.
Do songs mean different things every time you play them years later?
Not every time, but they as you go through different things on a different night, it's cool because a lot of the songs can mean a lot of different things, and I'll take it to apply to my life at the time.
Okay, we've got a text question right here. It's from Matthew in Montreal. He says, do you listen to your own music? I guess that segues perfectly.
Yeah. After we finished recording the album, I think, like, I don't know, all we listened to for the first month was The Open Door over and over and over, really loud in the car.
What did you think when you heard it?
What?
What did you think when you heard it?
I thought it ruled.
I like that answer. I like that answer. We've got a window question. Do you want to go out?
Yeah.
I know it's cold, but...
Let's do it.
The fans will keep you warm.
All right.
Let's go outside. Justin's got a question.
Is it for me? Terry's
I think it's for both of you. Terry, you can come on out.
All right.
Terry, stay inside.
Okay.
All right. We lost Terry. Justin, Amy.
Hi.
What's your question?
Okay, so out of all the songs you've ever recorded, what has to be your favorite song and why?
That I've ever recorded?
Yeah.
I wish I had Terry now. Darn.
Where is it?
I think You're Star. It's one of the most challenging and hard songs we've ever written, and it was just really fun. Even writing it, just trying to play, like, the little piano and guitar solo dueling thing, like, over and over and over again without making a mistake. We were, like, up till about 6 in the morning, like, just cracking up and trying to do it. We would have liked to play it tonight, but we didn't have all the tools here, but you can see it at the show. So.
Those must be the funnest times, is, you know, at 6 a.m. in the studio.
Is it done? You want a hug?
I'm going to fall.
Sorry.
Those must be, the funnest times as a musician. I mean, tooling in the studio, having fun at 6 a.m. in the morning.
Yeah, actually, because you sit around for, a month on end without a really good idea, and then finally you get going and you can't stop, so you're up all night. It's a good feeling.
All right, well, we've got the incarnations of those ideas. We'll talk about more music on our Live at Match after the break. Yeah! Evanescence, still tons more music to come. You guys having fun? Are you having fun? You having a good time? All right, give it up for Evanescence. We'll be right back.
We got one more, you guys. Thanks for being awesome! We love you, Toronto!
Amy, good to see you again. Terry, thanks for... Terry's off her attention. So, world tour after this, what happens now?
Yeah, we got a show tomorrow night. Woo! I don't know where we're going to be, like, what, Winnipeg, Ottawa, somewhere. Ottawa?
Ottawa. These guys already know.
I'll see you there.
You got to promise to come back and visit us.
I promise. I swear.
We got tons more people outside. Will you walk with me outside, Amy? To say final goodbye to the people outside. Evanescence coming outside, Amy, for the last time. Come on out. What's that?
I left my Sharpie.
Oh. Thank you very much again for being here. Thank you. Thank you for tuning in to our live at Much. We'll see you next time.